Hello and brace yourself, for today we are going to have to cover quite some ground. First of all, I want to do a bit of a recap. Where did we make some of all of these drawings and stuff we did? A lot of, I think most of these are lost, but anyways, as you can see in this figure here, that is the actual transistors inverters, and how the first one is just your transistor inverter, and how we can wire these to either get our NOT AND gate or our NOT OR gate. And as we've talked about, your redstone torch can function as a NOT gate. And since we have our NOT gate and we can wire these, we can make our NOT AND, our NOT OR gates. And if we not those gates, we can make our AND and our OR gates. And we talked about how the truth tables for these would look. And we have those here. Likewise, you can see the symbols we'll be using for these five basic gates. And you will be happy to know that I will try not to draw too many truth tables on signs. Because, well, it can get a bit confusing to look at. At least that's what I think. Anyways, we also looked at, and I think we actually have that. Yeah, I think that's part of it. A bit condensed, anyways. But how we looked at how we could create a circuit that would compute a function, a Boolean function, and I showed at least the majority function of three variables, both the truth table, as you can see here, and the circuit for it, and how we are able to implement this in redstone. Talk a bit about equivalence, and we have that here. Question is, yep, we have the redstone implementation, and if we look at the circuits and the truth table for these, we looked a bit about that, and the really interesting thing here is that it's obvious that some implementations require less gates, but how do we optimize this? And we looked at the point where we could see that the identities of our normal algebra also holds true for our Boolean algebra. That is our null law and the commutative law and such as this. And while a truth table is unique for a function, there is several implementations of circuits. So what you could do is that you could get your Boolean function and do your normal algebra or your Boolean algebra on that in order to optimize the number of gates that, let's try that again, in order to optimize the number of gates that you need to use when you implement this in your redstone. We had a little bit of talk about the exclusive OR. And as you can see here, there are also different circuits for implementing the exclusive OR. And this here will be the symbol that this here will be the symbol that we will use for that, and the truth table for it. And now I want to talk a bit about the things that you need to worry about when you work with actual redstone. Because redstone, unfortunately, does not work like electrical current. There are some limitations to it. For instance, if I were to make a line here, you would expect this to light up when I flip the switch. But it doesn't. Because the power in redstone can only travel so far. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. And as you can see, this one is not powered on. So if we do it like that. So that's one thing that will, while it seems like a when we have the redstone repeater here, it seems like it's not going to be a real problem. It does prove to be quite challenging, because there is a propagation time through the repeaters as opposed to just your normal redstone. As you can see here, we have simulated a wire, but just using repeaters into this piston. Likewise, while this is actually two blocks longer, we will see that this one will indeed get power before this one. That tells us that there is, and we can see it very clearly, the propagation time through the repeaters. As you can see here, if I remove one repeater, this one here should be firing before this one. And I suppose it is, but from the naked eye, that's quite difficult to see. Now, if I remove two instead of one, we can see that we have a bit of a difference there. So, when we decide, if we want to design something that is critical in terms of timing, we need to be aware of the time that, or we need to be aware at least that it does take some time for the redstone power to run through these repeaters. So all in all, if we want to make something that is fast, we should be minimizing the use. But then again, sometimes it is just a lot easier to to use these instead. Of course, we could be looking at using old version of the repeater, where you actually just power into, where you actually just use your NOT gate in order to have the power travel further. And of course, you would have your 16 blocks of difference here, but I did not want to go 64 blocks down that way. in order to illustrate this. So I just imagine we have 16 blocks, this one block. And when it comes to here, we can invert it one more time. So the output will be the same. Likewise, if we needed to do this twice, as I said, we needed to move this, the first 16 and 16, that's 32, and 16 and 16, that's 64. So if we wanted to move this 64 blocks down that way, we would have to use these four inverters in order to get the correct signal out in the end. Let's see if I put down these here, which should be the equivalent. It's just about the same thing. So there's no real reason to start out with in order to do this. Sometimes you can make your circuits. You can make your circuits use the fact that this might be inverted and thus create something a bit more efficient. Of course, if you just needed to move it to 32 and you still needed it to be inverted, you would need to have two of these. But you could cut down on your repeaters. So sometimes you can make this one faster and sometimes you can make this one faster. Really depends on what you need at the current time. Now, next up, the actual redstone torch has some properties we need to be aware of. It can actually burn out if we power it on and off too fast. So if I would make something like this, you can see it burns out. Yeah. So you need to, in order to stabilize this, you need to have a delay. That looks odd. Anyways. Oh. That is. If you wanted to make something. You could do something like this. In order to make a really fast blink device clock thingy. As you can see here, these do get burned out, but then another one takes over, and it's not like it's actually random. You see how fast this one is. Problem is, if we have something that's that fast, what can we use it for? Because there is a couple of things that we need to be aware of. Like with a sticky piston. As you can see, when things move too fast, it does not do what you actually think it should do. Pull up and grab down. It leaves this one up in the air every second time, because it moves too fast. So that's also something that we need to be aware of when we work with redstone and with pistons. The good thing about piston is that they don't really burn out. And on that note, we can use them for You can use them for clocks and stuff like that. Since we don't need them, since they won't burn out. Now, where did I put that? Let's take a look at that one. Now, we talked about that we could only send these signals 16. Before we needed to have a repeater, but likewise, what if we wanted, how long can we send them? Because there is a limitation. There is a limitation to this. As you can see here, I've built this from the bottom of the world. And all the way up to our new height limit at 256. And the reason I have the blink device down there is that I wanted to make sure that the clock, that these will get updated. Because if I just powered this one up, this one would power this one, would power this one, would power this one. So if the one at the bottom had, if something had happened to that, I might not be able to detect that, because these would still have the power or the state that they had received from that point on. So in order to make sure that my state from the bottom of the world is getting transferred up to the top of the world, I've made this into a I made it to as a clock. Yeah, so as you can see, this one will power it all the way up to the top here. Just turn it off for now. But what if we want to send it the other way? Let's see what... Hello? Yeah. So basically here we send them one chunk at a time this way. Just a really long way. So we can see that our clock, that our state here is getting transferred all the way down this way, right down. Now, as you might notice here, I kind of stopped doing that, and as you can see right now, something has happened. With our state, it's not blinking anymore. That's because when you get out of a certain range from a redstone torch, or the chunk that the torch is in. If you don't know what a chunk is, this is a chunk you see here, all the way from the bottom and all the way up to the top is one chunk, and then we'll have like a chunk here and here, and Minecraft world is built from chunks. And when you get a certain distance away from a chunk, it will stop updating. The redstone torch in it will not update as it's supposed to. It will eventually start updating itself again. It will reset. Like if we had our this fast blink device we had over here. As you can see, it has, even though we went very far away from it, it has now reset itself and started again. And that's why if you need to build something where you'll be moving out of range, if you need to build like a clock where you'll be moving out of range, if you make it with like this, with the repeaters, and you moved out of range, then the redstone here will stop updating, and when you move back into range, it will not reset itself because it does not have a torch to do that. So it cannot. And that's why your old school clocks will work better for that purpose, since the redstone torch here will reset itself and keep the circuit going after a certain amount of time. The actual number of chunks that you need to is the critical point. There is, I don't know, maybe it's 10, 15, because it kind of depends on if you're building on a server. It's server dependent, so depending on how the admin of the server had set up. So it might be wiser to build vertically than horizontally in that regard, because then you at least know that you will be within the chunk, and you will have your updates as you're supposed to. Right. Here we have a small tower transferring redstone vertically. It is. You can move inside it, so it is useful if you're for actually building. Another thing that's nice about it is that you can use it, the same structure, if you wanted to transfer the redstone down again. Now I just moved it over here instead. So if you want to transfer redstone up and down, this is a very useful structure. Likewise, you could shoot it directly up in the air, and as you can see, this is not something you can move on. The thing is, though, you can't get it to shoot directly down. If you want to move it downwards, you need to make something like this, where you alternate these. But it's pretty space efficient, at least, as opposed to this one. It's a little bit smaller, but since you'll be working with the redstone torches, there is, as we recall from before, the propagation time. So if I flick this switch, I would really like to have this one turn off while this one turned on. But as you can see, that's not the case. So as we have talked about, that's one of the things that we need to be aware of when we do work with stuff like this, especially if we are building circuits that are prone for some race conditions or things like that. Or need to time our bus to be stable before we can actually read a value from it. Stuff like that. So next up, we'll be our final bit today. We'll be looking at this baby, an 8-input multiplexer circuit, 8-to-1. So, or what is it, and why is that of any interest? What we can say is that on the digital logic level, a multiplexer is a circuit with 2^n data inputs and 1 data output. And we have n control inputs. Right? And the control inputs select one of these data inputs. What we do is we take the selected data input and it is gated to the output. So if you look here at our schematic, we can see that our 3 control lines, our A, B, and our C, which encode this 3-bit number that specifies which of the 8 input lines is gated to the OR gate and thus to the output. No matter what the value is on the control lines, 7 of the AND gates will always have the output 0. And the last one may output either a 0 or a 1, depending on the value on the input line. And then we can enable the AND gate with AND gate we want to use by the different combinations on our control inputs. We could, like, when we have this, we could implement our majority function with this. And actually we could implement any truth table of 3 variables with this setup. So anything you have where you have a truth table with 3 variables, we can implement using the multiplexer. So it's, for what it's worth, it's a really, really, really nice thing. It have other purposes, of its applications is like used to be a parallel to a serial data converter, like on a telephone line. There's also when we have a multiplexer, we also have the demultiplexer, which routes its single input signal to one of its 2^n outputs, depending on the values of the n control lines. So if the binary value on the control lines is k, output k is selected. As you can see here, we will be needing a AND gate with 4 inputs. And what I've done here is created that. It will only turn on when we have all our inputs on. Likewise, we'll be using an 8 input OR gate. But luckily, OR gates are not that difficult to, are not that, resource. Because an OR gate is just basically this line here. So, what we have done here at the implementation of the circuit, at our OR gates, our 8 input OR gate is just here where we actually just we send this. If one of these turns on, you know, we need the power to be on, so we just send it down here. Our other 4 outputs from our AND gates coming down this way. And we can see the output F over here. And inside here, we will have our 4 input AND gates all the way down to here. And then it's just a matter of actually wiring these things up correctly. As you can see, it looks almost identically all the way down, with a few subtle differences, depending on whether or not we want to read this from our A or our not A, our B or our not B, or our C or our not C. So, like here, this line here is our not. Our not C, while this here is C. Instead of actually using a line for our not C and a line for our C or A not A, I decided to just use one bus line, so to speak, and then depending on what I need of the input into the AND gate, we will either not it or not. And that's no pun intended. And as we can see now, this is pretty big, of course, and it's not done in any space-efficient way. If we talk about doing stuff like this, we could have stacked these somewhat on top of each other instead. That's kind of tad difficult to draw. If you want to look at the drawings of this, this should be almost very close to the actual schematic. The only thing that's a bit different is the fact that we only use these three lines, and then we either not on our input or to the actual gate, because that's at least what I figured. What is at least a tad more easy when you're doing it with the redstones here. Now, if we go back to our majority function, how do we implement the majority function using a multiplexer? Well, if you look at the truth table, you can see in our, if you look at our rows, these rows, this would be D0, D1, D2, and down to D7. So, if you look at our rows, if you look at our row 0, so to speak, in our majority function, the truth table, we can see that the value in that will be a 0. Likewise, if we take them, the next one will be 0, then 0, then 1, then 0, then 1, then 1, and then 1. So, if I program this, so to speak, to a 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, and 1. I want to turn these off. Now let's have a quick look at the truth table. So this would be 0, 0, 0. So I would expect our output to be 0. The next one is 0, 0, 1. I would expect our output to be 0. Then we'll have 0 runs, 0, 1, 0. And again, I'd expect our output to be 0. Now we'll have a 0, 1, 1, and I would expect our output to be a 1. Yeah. 100, and our output should be 0. One, and we would have our output to be 1. Yep. And 110. 110. Our output should be 1. And at last, 111. And our output should be 1. Yes. So, this is the way that you could set up a multiplexer to compute the majority function. If you remember, like we have here, we could use this one to implement it as well. So let's look at that. So our output, if we program it, this one should be a 0, 0, 0, 0, and 0, and the last one should be 1. Yeah. Then we can run through the same motions again. So 0, 0, 0 should be a 0. 0, 0, 1 should be a 0. 0, 1, 0 should be a 0. Yeah. And the 0, 0, 1, 1 should be a 0. 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 should be a 0. Yeah. 1, 0, 1, that should be a 1. Oh yeah. 1, 1, 0 should be a 1. Yeah, and finally 1, 1, 1 should be a 1. So as you can see, any Boolean function of 3 variables you can implement using this multiplexer. There are different sizes of multiplexers, like a 2-to-1 or 4-to-1, or like this, an 8-to-1. You could chain them. You could have a 2-4-to-1 multiplexers and have the output of those two into a 2-to-1 multiplexer. And that way you could chain the 2 4-to-1 and the 1 2-to-1 multiplexers into an 8-to-1 multiplexer. So, but I don't think I'll be needing anything bigger than this, at least for now. Yeah, and I think for as far as multiplexers go, I don't think we'll look at that anymore for now. This is, as you can see in the more intricate part of it, is that this is not done in a time-efficient or space-efficient way. It's done in order to be easy to look at and understand. There's obviously not 16 blocks from here to here, but in order to make sure that we have this uniform all the way down, it is done like this, and stuff like that. But when you actually built circuits to be used in computing something, you might want to be looking at, you want to optimize it. But for now, this is the computer science and not the electric engineering. So for now, I think we'll be satisfied with this, and the next time we'll be looking at decoder, I think, or a comparator, something, maybe both. We'll see, but the decoder is probably going to take up the full amount of time. So So for now, have fun building, and remember to test it out and implement some truth tables using this, because it's quite neat. Bye.